In this video, we'll go over how to use shapes and text in order to create masks. These masks can be for one-time use, or they can be saved for repeated use. Before we get started, if you're watching this video on YouTube, you'll find a link in the description below that will take you to our tutorial page on Corel's Discovery Center. Here you can also download a written copy of this tutorial, along with sample images you can download to try out the steps yourself. In the previous videos in this series, we've seen examples of PaintShop Pro's pre-installed masks, as well as examples of creating new masks from scratch and from images. We'll take new masks a step further in this video using shapes and text. I'm starting with this flower image, and I'll find a shape from the preset shape tool. I want to create my shape as a vector so that the shape can be used for cutting. I'll click the current shape and choose one of the star outlines. Then I'll click and drag to place the shape on the image, and the shape appears on its own vector layer. One way to use this shape to contain the image below is to use it as a cutter. When I click Shape Cutter, I get a new image with a filled star shape on a transparent background. To place this shape in a new image, such as this solid-filled rectangle, I can just drag its layer right onto the solid image. Then I can use the Pick tool to resize or move or rotate it. I can do something similar with masks, and this technique also gives me a bit more flexibility in how the shape is used. I'll close the cutout shape without saving and return to the flower image, where I'll use Undo to remove the extra shape layers. I'll place a new layer on top of the flower background and flood fill this new layer. I'll also create a new image using File, New. I'll use 5x7, but the size isn't important because mask size can be adjusted. I'll flood fill this rectangle with black. I'll click Preset Shape again, and the star is still the current shape. With Retain Style unchecked, the star will be filled with the background color, so I'll make this color white. I'll drag in the star and stretch and rotate it a bit. To make this shape less sharp, I'll add a blur. When I choose Adjust, Blur, Gaussian Blur, the message says that the vector layer must be converted to a raster layer first. I'll click OK. Then I'll adjust the blur radius and click OK again. Going back to the solid covered flower image, and with the solid layer active, I'll click the new mask layer icon and choose From Image. I'll choose the star image, use the source luminance option, and invert the mask so that the solid border will show and the center will be blocked. This produces a similar result as the shape cutter, this time with blurred edges. When a mask is applied from an image, it automatically fills the canvas, but I could adjust the mask placement with the Pick tool. But if I want to be able to use this image as a mask again and have a bit more placement flexibility, I can save the mask as a preset. With the mask layer selected, I'll choose Layers, Load Save Mask, Save Mask to Disk. Note that the preview image shows a white background and a black star, which is because the star image was inverted before it was applied to the flowers. I'll name this mask Star and click Save. Now I can apply this mask anywhere. I now have this birthday photo open with a solid filled layer below. With the photo layer active, I'll choose Layers, Load Save Mask, Load Mask from Disk. I'll find the star from the alphabetical list, choose As Is, so that the mask placement can be easily adjusted, and I'll make this a hide all mask so that the rest of the photo layer will be blocked. The mask was saved with a white background and a black star, so now I have to invert it again to make the star white and the background black. Now with the mask layer active, I'll use the Pick tool to adjust it to highlight the stars of the photo. Of course, I'm not limited to the pre-installed shapes that come with PaintShop Pro. Here's a swirl image, black in the center, white along the edges, and some bits of gray in between. I could use From Image to apply this mask to any photo, but if I want to use the mask more than once, I can save it as a preset. As we've seen, I can do this by first applying this image as a mask onto any other image, but it's also easy to just apply this mask to itself. I'll choose From Image, leave the source image as itself, invert it so that black will be on the outside, and apply. Then, with the mask layer selected, I'll save it to Disk and name it Swirl. I don't need this image anymore, so I'll close without saving. Back to my birthday photo, I want to remove the current mask and replace it with the swirl. I can't just delete the mask group layer, because that will delete the photo layer it contains. So instead, I'll right-click on the mask group and ungroup it. Then I can delete the star mask, choosing not to merge it with the layer below. Now the photo layer is active. I'll load from disk and find swirl. As before, I'll use as is and hide all, and I'll uncheck invert. And after applying, I'll use the pick tool to adjust. Text can also be made into a mask. I have this beach photo open, and I'll click the text tool, set my font, and the colors don't matter since the text will be cut from the photo. I'll click on the photo and start typing. I'll double click to finish, then I can adjust the size and placement. Just like with shapes, I can use text as a cutout. I'll click Cutter Preview, place the text so that it contains the parts I want from the photo, then click Text Cutter. I get a new image with a colorful text on a transparent background. This colorful text would look interesting when placed on a contrasting beach sunset photo, but I'll undo. I can use this text image to make the mask I want to use. With the background color set to white, I'll activate the Color Replacer tool. I'll set a high tolerance and right-click and drag to replace all colors with white. The transparent background is treated as a black color for the mask. This is the type of mask image I could also have created from scratch, using the text tool to create white letters on a black or transparent canvas. Instead of saving this text as a preset, I'll just apply it back to the daytime beach photo. This image has a couple of extra layers from the text cutout operation, which aren't turned on, but to keep things clean, I'll delete these layers anyway. I'll choose From Image, find the text image, make it not inverted, and apply. To fill in the transparency below the mask, I'll open the beach sunset photo and drag its photo layer onto the daytime image. Then I'll drag the new sunset layer below and outside the mask group. To see how the reverse image would look, I'll go back to the sunset photo. I'll apply the same text image as the mask. Then I'll go back to the daytime image, find its original photo layer, and drag it onto the sunset. Then I'll do the same layer move, placing the beach below the sunset mask group and adjusting its size. One last note about masks on the disk. I'll choose Layers, Load Save Mask, Load Mask from Disk, and click the current mask. I can click File Locations to see where mask images are stored. This folder has the pre-installed masks, and this one has the ones I've saved. And if I click Resource Manager, I can delete, rename, copy, or move mask images. This brings us to the end of this tutorial on shape and text masks. If you've been watching this video on YouTube, please follow the link in the description below, which will take you to this tutorial page in Corel's Discovery Center. Here you'll find a written version of this tutorial, along with sample images you can download and follow along.